not agree. There are many such examples based on the recent developed techniques. For example, localization of integrability or conformal bootstrap approach. And today's talk is based on the integrability. And typically, a quantity in NSCFT has the following weak and strong coupling expansion. At weak coupling, some quantity f of lambda is expanded by the usual lambda expansion. And on the other hand, if we take the large lambda limit, this quantity is expanded by scale, the one of scale lambda behavior. And these coefficients should be compared to the gauge theory computation or string theory computation. And one natural question is, if we know the exact result, the natural question is, can we introduce the exact result from the only from the weak coupling expansion or strong coupling expansion? Here I call it as a summation problem. And let me explain the one example of such case. We consider the expectation value of the half BPS circular Wilson. As well known, this result can be derived by using the localization by test. And the result is exactly written by the modified Wessel function. And on the other hand, there is a Feynman diagrammatic computation in the gauge theory side. This is much more as a work. And Ericsson Serino's triangle computing the all order expansion of the half BPS Wilson loop based on assuming some others. And they get the all order expression. And it's easy to sum up this all order expression, and then we get the same result by the localization. So in this case, weak coupling expansion is easily disarmed in all order of the pattern theory. But in my talk, I will try to explain that the strong coupling expansion is much more difficult. And this is the theme of my talk. So in this talk, I'm interested in the so-called Kaspar mass dimension. And this function is very important in the field, any purpose dimension or some more field theory. And remarkably, in any purpose dimension, this function can be computed exactly due to the integrability. And I explain the problem how to resum the strong coupling expansion to this function. And I think this problem is conceptually important in many other contexts, and including maybe we are interested in the strong coupling expansion of the language. I hope that my talk is useful for future direction to the strong coupling analysis in the language. And this is my plan of my talk. In the next part, I will try to explain briefly review the Kaspar mass dimension in any purpose dimensions. And then next part, I briefly review the Borelli summation technique. At strong coupling, we need the Borelli summation to resum the strong coupling expansion. And finally, I report my result with Doigoni about the strong coupling summation for the Kaspar mass dimension. Let me start with the Kaspar mass dimension. The Kaspar mass dimension is a very important object in the field theory, some gauge theory. And in the any-purpose pyramids, the Kaspar mass dimension appears in many various contexts. It appears as a UV divergence of the level of Wilson line is. And it also appears dimension for the higher speed operator. So to understand the customer's dimension is a very important task. So this is the main motivation to consider the customer's dimension. And very surprisingly, in technical process dynamics, thanks to the integrability, the customer's dimension is exactly computed by certain integral equation, known as by the Bayes-Stadler equation. And the Bayes-Stadler equation schematically takes such form. And this is the integral equation with respect to the Hamilton function sigma t, sigma of t. And the integral kernel k takes a very complicated form, but it can be explicitly written in terms of the Hessel function. So once this kernel and t is a parameter of the integral equation, and g is a coupling of the Bayes-Stadler theory. In my talk, I use the notation of the g is a square root lambda over 4 pi. So this once this coupling g is given, then this integral equation is solves the Hamilton function sigma uniquely. And once this function sigma is obtained, the customer's dimension can be computed by setting t equal 0 for sigma. So in this way, Bayes-Stadler equation determines the customer's dimension for any coupling. This is a very remarkable result. And if we are interested in the decoupling regime, then the problem is easily solved. The Bayes-Stadler DES equation can be solved by decoupling alternatively order by order. And using this solution, we get the decoupling expansion of the customer's dimension. The result is following. And this alternative result exactly agree with the field theoretical computation. So the Bayes-Stadler equation is strongly believed to the correct give the correct answer of the customer's dimension. And the important observation is that this summation is very likely convergent series with finite radius, g for 1.4. And this means that the perturbative information of the free coupling expansion is sufficient to reconstruct the exact answer. So a free coupling regime, what we should do is to compute this perturbative expansion order by order. And DES equation can be solved for any coupling. And I plot the behavior of this function for finite coupling. At weak coupling, in the region near the g equals 0, by the DES equation predicts the weak coupling behavior. And this is means the g squared behavior. And also, at strong coupling, the transparent dimension should be behavior linearly, and DES equation agrees with this behavior. So the transparent dimension DES equation smoothly interpolates from the weak coupling regime to strong coupling regime. And the problem I want to consider is how to get this finite coupling result from the strong coupling summation. This is the main problem my talk. And to do so, let me briefly use the Bayes-Stadler summation method. The Bayes-Stadler summation is a standard way to resolve the formal divergence series. here, we start with some formal power series like this one. And we assume that the coefficient of A is factorially divergent in the large order limit. An goes to behaviors n factorial in the A goes to infinity. So this, namely, this term is a divergent series, and this is only the formal power series. But we can make this term meaning. Let us let me devise Fourier transform of the power series. Then the Fourier transform of A is defined by this form, and we devise an by n factorial. Due to this factor, the Fourier transform is now a convergent series with finite radius, and this term is well defined. Not formal, but as meaning, as meaning. And if we know the Fourier transform, the Fourier summation of the original power series A is defined by this integral transform, inverse Laplace transform. This is the definition of the Fourier summation. And let me consider a very simple example to simple Fourier summation method. We consider a very simple example. The coefficient is given by the minus 1 n times n factorial. Obviously, this series is divergent. But we can perform the Fourier summation that it's easy to see that the Fourier summation of this power series is given by this form, and this sum is obviously convergent, and we can perform the sum exactly. So then the Fourier summation of this power series is given by this form, and this integral also can be performed by exactly, and the result is written by the incomplete gamma function. Once we know this analytic expression, so this power series can be analytically continued arbitrary value z. In the original power series, it's divergent series, so here I show the first five term contribution. It immediately grows divergent. But after the Fourier summation, the function is analytically continued for each of the real positive real thing. This is a very simple example of the Fourier summation. And I want to consider the I want to return to the original example of the circular Wilson loop. As I saw before, the level of the Wilson loop is exactly written in terms of the modified Bessel function. And one can find the expansion of the modified Bessel function at infinity. The modified Bessel function is expanded at this form, equal to infinity. And there are two contributions of the expansion. And the coefficient is exactly given by this form. And this coefficient is divergent factorially. So this expansion is formal divergent C. And here we want to discount the right hand side and how to get the original result function of this function. So first, what we should do first we know that exact expression of the coefficient, we can perform the Fourier transform exact, and the result is given by hypergeometric function. And once we know the Fourier transform, we can write down the Fourier summation of each contribution. I denote the first contribution is the FP, and the other is the and these two expressions is commonly written by this form, but there is a problem of this integral because the hypergeometric function as the branch cut at t equals the branch point at t equals 1. So this integral has no similarity on the real positive real axis, but this integral has a singularity on the positive real axis. T equals 1 is a singularity. So this integral is not well defined quantity. So we cure this problem. We have to cure this problem. And this can be done as the following form. So called the lateral Fourier summation method. If the Fourier transform has singularity on the positive real axis, we have to avoid the singularity on the positive real axis. And there are two possibilities to deform the integral contour. One is to avoid the singularity on the left side, and the other is avoid the singularity on the right side. And we can define the two lateral Fourier summation of this form. And on this line, there are no similarity. So this Fourier summation is a well defined quantity. But in general, these two summations lead to different results. This is often called the perturbative ambiguity of the Fourier summation. And the difference of these two summations has the order exponential minus 1 over g contribution. So, naively, if we consider the lateral Fourier summation of this function, the Fourier summation is no longer unique answer, does not give the unique answer, but there is a very beautiful resolution of the cancel the non-perturbative ambiguity. The non-perturbative ambiguity of the lateral Fourier summation is precisely canceled by the non-perturbative contribution of the in this case the second term cancels the ambiguity of the first Fourier summation. Here I wrote the exact numerical value of the at z equal 1 case. At z equal 1, the lateral Fourier summation of the first term is this value, and this is no longer, this is not complex part. But if you consider the second contribution, is a plus sign, then this contribution is precisely cancels the imaginary part of the first term. And the real part and the sum of these two contributions precisely gives the exact result of the and if we consider the other choice of the lateral Fourier summation, then we get the complex conjugate of this contribution. But in this time, if we choose the minus sign of the second term, then this imaginary part is again cancelled by the second term. And
Are these two contributions just from the two different species? Is that contours as you deform the phase?
but this ability must be transferred by the instant loop for the user.
I saw the circular version of Virgin and possibly an alternative to an instant.
Yeah, yeah.
So the world should instant
on it's not instant on the side, right? Yeah, yeah. I think if we consider the string theory of this program here of this instant loop, we found two saddle point solutions. And one saddle point corresponds to this instant loop. And the other saddle point
gamma 0, gamma 1, gamma 2, etc. How are these defined?
I choose the notation of the leading term.
But if the sum doesn't converge, that's not so meaningful. So what is, I mean, is it unambiguously, are they unambiguously defined in the top equation?
Oh, no, no, no.
I mean, the gamma 0, gamma 1, gamma 2, what, are these well-defined functions?
Yeah, yeah, this,
and how are they defined?
Ah, this is a polar Tauchy series.
No, no, but I understand, but both gamma 1, 0, 1, 2, you know, and the lambda are functions of G. Is it clear you can separate them in an unambiguous way like this?
Yeah, yeah, I think that in, let
I mean, why can I group the higher order to a lower order gamma, since you haven't specified what the gamma 0 is? What is the meaning of gamma 0?
The reason that this thing is that you have a non-analytic dependent, so if you expand this exponential of pi g, the powers of g, coefficients of 0 for all of it.
No, it's the top line. Well,
the
top
powers of 1 of g, so it's not really in 1 of g.
Does the top line converge? The top equation earlier with gamma 0, gamma 1, gamma 2.
This
is? No, no, this is the top. If gamma is a well-defined function.
I think that this the expansion is instead to lambda is convergent.
Oh.
I think. But each set that has asymptotic expansion. This sum is a divergent series and a non-Borel sum. So what we should do is to compute the these coefficients. Order by order. And unfortunately, we do not know the all order expression of each expansion. And we might work with the one we computed the coefficient gamma lambda n up to L equal 180 for part C sector. And so we know we have the only finite number of coefficients. We have to truncate the Borel transform up to some finite number of L. And in practical computation, we use the Fadian approximant of the Borel transform. And so I call the such Borel sum by using the Fadian approximant as a Borel Fadian summation here. This is a practical and first, we have to see the singularity structure in the Borel transform. And we have computed the part of U series up to L equal 180. So the Fadian approximant gives a singularity structure of the part of U series. And the Fadian approximant predicts that the Borel transform has two branch cuts in the Borel plane. And one is located at on positive real axis from t equal 1. And we found that there is another branch cut starting